assignment, according to you, God, is that he would be our comforter. And so, Lord, we come and we say thank you for the comforter. Thank you that he is present here, that he delights in being with us, and that he's the one that can really, in the midst of this day, bring us to the mindset of being joyful. Not happy, but joyful. And we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you also for the gift of music, as we have some special songs throughout our time here together that were special to Leonard, but also the words are what's most important. So we thank you for these special songs. In Jesus' name, amen. Here's one that I think you're
That day has come. That day has come. Leonard was born here in Reading. Was raised by his mother, Linda, and his grandmother, Mildred. And they always said what a wonderful, God-fearing women they were, both of them. He felt like God blessed them so much by allowing those two ladies to be such an important part of his life. He would always say, I had a mother and grandmother to show me what to do. And I had an uncle that showed me not what to do. And so he's so thankful for that strong woman. Not only did he raise, was he raised by her, but they raised his sister also with it.
And we're so thankful for that. When Leonard was 18 years old, he was able to meet his father
for the first time. And one of the blessings is the friendship that developed. Tragically, it was only a short blessing because they only had 2 years together before he passed. But mostly whenever they could on the weekends, they'd get together. They'd work on cars and big diesels and whatever he could do. He could just kind of be there with his dad. But growing up in Reading, they did move around quite a bit and always found their way back home, back to Reading. And he's so thankful for that. And they'd pack up and move and come back again. But one of the memories that he fondly have of his mom be loading up the car, getting a loaf of bread or a package of hot dogs and bologna, and hitting the road for a day of adventure, which actually continued to carry on, as Terry was sharing me. And then he'd often say, make sure you smash the bread before we go. His hobbies, anything with an engine, kind of got his heart going. From cars, trucks, boats, sandrails, go-karts, mini bikes. If it had an engine, he wanted it to go faster. And he loved that. He couldn't just buy something and let it go. He wanted to get every single ounce of power out of that machine. And he just had a way of figuring out, we can get a little bit more if we do this or that. His passions, number one, without a doubt, was Jesus Christ. Without a doubt, that he loved to worship the Lord. I remember one Saturday I was praying for our church. And I remember crying out to the Lord, not complaining, but just wanting to see God do more things in our fellowship. And I said, Lord, I would love it if you would move on the men of our church to lead our church in worship, that they would be the ones that would be free to worship. And so I came in on Sunday morning. We began singing. This was like a decade ago. We started singing the first song, and the first song was Leonard. He just came forward. He was on his knees. Almost every Sunday he was here during worship, he'd be on his knees, not thinking about anybody but Jesus. Said, thank you, God. Thank you, God. His passion. And so when he got his Harley and a street car, he said, Lord, I'd like to put a scripture on there. And so the scripture he put specifically was John 3:17. He knew what that would do. He knew what people would respond to that. And throughout the years, so many would say, John 3:17. I've heard of John 3:16. What's John 3:17? And it just opened up this opportunity to talk about Jesus Christ, to talk about the Lord. And he would use us to witness over and over and over, whether at a drag strip, at a car show, over and over and over. And by the way, as he'd smile, he'd get to share what John 3:17 is. And to me, it's just as powerful. For most of us know, for God so loved the world, but why? Verse 17, for God did not send his son to the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. That's what it's all about. He also was passionate about his grandchildren. There's nothing he wouldn't do for his 6 grandkids. He made sure that they'd have memories and that they would never forget Papa. And I think that's a beautiful thing. Another passion was his drag racing. He loved it and enjoyed being there. And then we can't say his passion wasn't Terry, because it was. Terry shares, and she'll share in just a little bit, but Leonard and I met through Leonard's son, Wayne. She and Wayne were working together, and Leonard was going through a divorce, and Wayne knew that Terry was a paralegal. And so she set it up for Leonard just to come to meet at the house. And as she says, Leonard, I'm quoting her, not me, Leonard was definitely nothing, all capitalized, that Terry would have been attracted to. First off, he was a Christian. Second of all, he was bald. I've never been attracted to bald men, and I was definitely nothing Leonard would have ever been attracted to as I looked at him at first. But I was about into my 3rd tequila sunrise by the time he arrived at Wayne's house. My father had passed away 2 years prior to me meeting Leonard, and I literally lost my mind, and I crawled into a bottle. So a few days later, when I was sober, we sat down and discussed his case and started preparing the paperwork. From there, we became friends. I quit drinking because I knew he didn't like it, and I really didn't like it either. Leonard always made me feel like a better person, just being in his presence, and that's all I needed at the time. We started walking the river trail, talking and getting to know one another, and he would always pester me about going to church, and I would always refuse. I'd had some bad experiences with the church that I grew up until I was 16 years old, and I swore at that point I'd never step foot in another church, and I didn't. Finally, Leonard said to me, "You know, you don't have to go to church for all of them." And he waved his arm and pointed to the crowd of people. "He go to church for you and him," as he pointed to heaven. Finally, just to shut him up, I told him that I would go to church with him just one day. So the following Sunday, when she walked into this building through the doors, I immediately felt at home. It was then that I gave my heart to God. And after that, we started dating, and I fell madly in love with him. I am so grateful for God's blessing with the time that I had with Leonard. And I wouldn't be where I am now. He was a great gift. So believe it or not, that's just the short story. Now one quick memory that she wanted to share just to talk about how stubborn they are. So one afternoon, after we became a couple, we hopped on the Harley one day and rode up to Lassen. We decided to go see these falls that we saw a sign for. Now remember, we were in our motorcycle gear. Most importantly, we're in motorcycle boots, not tennis shoes. So, since we both love the waterfalls, we began to head on down the trail. After a little over a mile, we still didn't see a waterfall. We asked people going the opposite direction of the trail, and they said, "Yeah, just a little ways further." So we kept going. By the time we got to the falls and back, we'd trekked almost 10 miles in our motorcycle boots. But our stubbornness had determined that we would just not quit until we saw those darn falls. We laughed at that so many times through the years about how we both need to work on our stubbornness and how bad our feet hurt at the end of it all. Memories, that's what really counts. That's what's the best deposit into our life, and we are so thankful for that. We'd like to take a few moments. The family has put together a special slide presentation. I think you'll be blessed by that. And then following this presentation, Terry's going to come up and share for just a few moments.
When I go, don't cry for me. In my Father's arms I'll be. Wounds this world left on my soul will all be healed and I'll be whole. Sun and moon will be replaced with the light Jesus fed. Washed away. So come and eat from heaven's store. Come and drink, and thirst no more. So weep not for me, my friend, when my time below does end. For my
thank you, everybody, for coming, and thank you to those that are watching. I know a lot of people are dealing with COVID and flu. I've gotten a lot of texts and phone calls. So thank you, Little Country, for making this, us be able to live stream it so that they don't miss out on Leonard Celebration of Life. We have so many memories, and I had one in my mind, and then I thought, well, no, this one's better, and then I thought, no, this one's better, and now my mind's at a complete blank of which one to share, but Leonard was just so much fun. He always talked about his pain and all of his surgeries and everything else. And he'd say, but I had so much fun. I wouldn't take it back for anything. And he always, every chance he got, he would minister to anybody. Hence the scripture on the car and the Harley. I'll never forget when here in town he got his spinal cord cut, and he lost half of his spinal fluid. They didn't think he was going to walk again. And I told the nurse and doctor, I said, please just don't tell him that. Just don't tell him that. And they didn't. And then, thankfully, when they figured out that it was a cut in his spinal cord, and he lost half of his fluid, thankfully, Dr. Page was in the operating room right next door, divine intervention, and she was able to fix it. But they still thought he wasn't going to walk. Well, came about that he took his steps, and he was fine. He was able to walk by the grace of God. But he walked with a drop foot, actually on his left foot. He walked with a drop foot. So we went down to Daly City, and that's when we met Dr. Goldthwait and found out that they were putting the wrong hardware in him. That's why it kept popping out. And he said that there was nothing he could do, though, about the drop foot. That was something that over the years would correct itself, or it wouldn't. So he had a surgery where he got all the right hardware in. That was difficult in and of itself. Long surgery, two-stage surgery. But it wound up that the first time they got him out of bed on Good Friday, The day that Jesus bore the stripes for his healing, Leonard said, I'm going to walk and I'm going to walk straight. And the physical therapist got him out of bed, and there he goes, perfectly straight. God healed that drop foot. He healed him. And he still lived in pain, but that was okay with Leonard because it opened up opportunity for him to witness. He was in so much pain one night there at the hospital, and he was just praising God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Father God. Thank you for being with me. Thank you for walking through this with me. And I'll never forget, the nurse came in and she said, I've worked on this unit. It was the 10th floor spinal unit there, Daly City. She said, I've worked in this unit for 10 years. And I've never seen anyone react to a surgery the way that you are. She said, everybody's cussing us. They're yelling and screaming. They're crying. I just don't understand you. And he said, because in all things, give thanks. He said, so many people forget that in all things, not just when we have money, not just when we have health, not just when we're happy, in all things, give thanks. He witnessed to the nurses. He witnessed to the doctors. He witnessed even to the cleaning crew. Anybody who would listen and a few that wouldn't, he witnessed to. And I'm just grateful and so thankful to God that he put Leonard in my life. I think everybody here and everybody watching is a better person just for knowing him. That's about it for now.
Tell us the story of why we're having our guest.
Oh, are we going to do the
bagpipe?
Yeah. Okay. So we got a bagpiper to come and play Amazing Grace. And the story behind that was Leonard always liked bagpipers, but he absolutely fell in love with the bagpipes, and in particular, Amazing Grace one day. He told me, he took me to this spot that through the years we went there and there was nobody ever there but me and him. We've never seen another living soul there. He took me to the spot and he told me that it was a very special spot. And I said, well, why? It's just very special to me. Okay, whatever. Went back. Why is this spot so special to you? It just is. Okay, whatever. About the third time, I was like, okay, I need to know why this spot is so special to you. And he told me, after his mom died, he was so distraught that he took a gun up to this spot and he was praying and he was praying and he was praying, and he didn't know if he was praying for God to talk him out of it or to get the strength to do it. But all of a sudden, right when he decided that he was going to do it, this bagpiper came out of nowhere and started playing Amazing Grace. And this bagpiper happened to have been a Christian, and they sat there and talked about the Lord. The bagpiper witnessed to Leonard. Leonard witnessed to the bagpiper. But ever since that day, the bagpipes, and especially Amazing Grace, have been so special to Leonard. And he always made me promise, if I die first, I don't care what you have to do, get a bagpiper at my funeral. And I said, I will. So that's why he's here today to share with us.
of the many things that's so wonderful about the Lord is he really does know how to meet us, where and when we need to meet him most, whether it's on a trail. You can't even, that's not even in a movie anywhere. This is real life. We wanted to give you an opportunity, if you'd like, just to stand and say a word or two. And if you wouldn't mind to come down to this microphone down here, that would help us because we are live streaming and want to make sure that those that aren't able to be here on campus can still be a part of it. And if you'd simply just give us your first name and just take a moment or two just to share, this would be the appropriate time to do that. Thank you, guys. Yeah. And just go ahead and make your way forward, and you can kind of get in line. And again, just give us your first name.
Hi, my name is Ray. A lot of the sons don't know me, but I've been in the family for over 30 years. I've always been in the back. Leonard, he actually showed me how to build a little bit of engine work when I was doing that kind of stuff. He also showed me about the Romanian Lord and love and understanding. I used to be a real bad boy. That didn't bother Leonard. He just kept with me and said, "Hey, Ray, there's always a new way. Why don't you try?" And I met what, that's when I had my wife. We were both on the real bad side. Leonard just said, "Dude, I got you covered. Come on with me. Let me show you stuff. Let me explain ways of life to you." And between him and a lot of people here at this church has shown me that, you know, the Lord's the only way of doing it. The Lord's is the way to make it. Not to bring up other people, John and Roger. They got me into prison ministry. Dude, I've been in prison too many times. I can't get in there. Joanne's words was, "Let me work at it. You'll be there." And, you know, I was approved, and I didn't believe it. And that's what I was talking to Leonard about. He goes, "Told you God has a weird way of working with you." And he does. And I just got to say, that's one guy I will miss, and I will love him no matter what. Thank you.
Thank you, Ray.
Yeah, my name is Don, and yeah, I know Leonard. He helped me a lot with my boat, my cars, my truck. He was always there. We always talked about the Lord when we worked with on my vehicles. We used to go fishing together, and every time we went fishing, I always caught the fish. He never caught the fish when we went fishing, and he was the fisherman. I wasn't, but it was kind of funny. One time we went fishing, I caught a duck, and it was a riot. I mean, it was a teenage duck, I believe, and I pulled it in, and Leonard got a hold of it. Of course, we knew we had a duck. We got the duck in the boat, and he's trying to take the hook out of the duck's beak, and his mama duck flying attacking him, and I'm trying to keep the duck off him, and we finally got it loose, and we got to, you know, get it loose, and then the mama duck and the baby took off, and I mean, you know, we had some good times. He was a great guy. I loved him, and yeah, he did love the Lord, and we shared, and well, that's part of it, but there's so much more, but that was a good time, good times.
Thanks, Don.
My name is Liz, and the first time Dana and I came to Little Country Church, I want to say 7 years ago, the first people we met were Leonard and Terry when we walked in the door. And after meeting them, we knew this was going to be our home. This was where we wanted to stay. I said, if anybody else in that church is like those people, I'm home. And I'm so glad we still have Terry. I just love her to death. But Leonard was one in a million to everybody. Thank you. Amen.
Thanks, Liz. Tim?
My name is Tim. And I knew Leonard was having a back surgery. So I made a point to be at Mercy after he had recovered. And he said, I was the first one there. And he was crying, and I was crying, because I had an injury in the military in my back, and I know it's no fun. But he said, Tim, I don't know if I'm going to make it. I said, Leonard, you will, with God's help. So I miss him. He had such a good attitude. He was a nice man, caring, and always wanted to talk about Christ. So he'll be missed, but we're going to join him someday.
Thanks, Tim.
Hi, my name's Vic, and Leonard and I became friends probably through racing and Christ, we both loved them equally as much, and Leonard was just a good guy, and me and my wife have had the privilege of having their Leonard and Terry's wedding at our garden, and we just thank them for bringing them both into our life, this year, me and Leonard talked about he was going to go to Bonneville with me, and hopefully he'll be there with me. Thank you.
Amen, Vic.
Well, begin with I'm Don, a.k.a. Grandpa. They were a very nice couple. Very nice. You couldn't be sad around Leonard. He'd always bring a smile to your face. He always had a smile on his face. He would talk, and it seems like God was inside of him, telling him what to say. He will be missed. And one of these days, I hope to see him up in glory. Thank you.
You want to say hi? You're not going to say hi first? I'm Chuck, Leonard's son-in-law. Whew, I'm trying to get through this. I was able to get him into the hunting and outdoor stuff, his archery stuff, later on in his life once racing was kind of backdoor. And say he was a little boy trapped in a grown man's body is an understatement. He's always so excited about things. I remember when he killed the big buck on rifle season. We weren't 30 minutes from the house. And about every 3 minutes, he'd be over there on the side of the truck, just, yes! The whole way down the hill. I'd sit there, like, you all right over there? He's like, yeah, we're good. Yes, I'm so excited. I was like, oh boy. So yep, this high's gonna ride a while. So it was good times. We got a lot of fun together out in the woods. Huh. Who's that up there? Who is that? Keep saying that's my papa, huh? Is that your papa? Say hi, papa.
So, apparently he was the first man that I ever met that could go fishing and hunting at the same time.
Right?
For a duck.
Yeah, no kidding, right?
Thank you for sharing that.
My name is Chris, and I've been going to Little Country Church for probably 12 years. I want to be a 5-year-old again and be barefoot like that guy. Jeez. I've known Leonard. So when I first started coming to Little Country Church, I had a bad addiction problem, and I didn't really have much direction in my life. And through the direction of someone else, I was led to Pastor Brian to go to men's Bible study. And that's where Leonard was, and a few other of the elders in the church, James Steyer and a few other guys. I don't know Leonard on like a hunting or trucks or cars or anything like that level, but I do know that he loved the Lord. I know that there was a patience about him and a grace about him. And hearing all the stories here today, it just reconfirms. And I'm happy that I came and I'm hearing the stories of Leonard. I do have a story. We were in Bible study, like, it was about 10 years ago, And we were doing probably the Truth Project or maybe Roman study with Max Lucado. And we were there, and something happened outside, something out of the ordinary. A couple guys left, and I think Leonard was one of them. And a few minutes later, somebody was calling the ambulance. And I don't know who, but the ambulance was called, and someone was taken away to the hospital. And at that time, I was like, I was working in forestry, and it was like I get off of work, and just to go to Bible study and be present was like my thing. Like, I was there, fine, you know? Like, I made the Bible study, right? And so, you know, tired, just like, oh, wow, what's going on, you know? And but the next week, this guy came in, and he had a seizure outside of the men's Bible study. I think it was on the sidewalk over here on Canby. And his name was Kevin Watson. And he started going to Bible studies, and Kevin's historically known for having seizures and living homeless at the time, I believe. Yeah, he was homeless at the time. And he started going to Bible studies, and we started loving on him. You know, everyone inside the Bible study started loving on him, and we befriended him. And but that I say all that to say that, you know, God puts us in situations to help people and to love on people and to call us out. And it's amazing to see celebrations of life like this, to see how people are called out and how, you know, it's we're honoring that person. We're honoring Leonard. And I didn't know him too much on a personal level. I'll go back to that. But that whole, to see that transpire in the very early stage of my Christian walk resonated in my heart, resonated in my spirit, you know. And the one instance I do have with him, talking to him, because I didn't talk a whole lot with him, like our paths after Bible study kind of went separate ways, but I would see him from time to time, and I do remember that he did like, you know, motorcycles and working on trucks, and he liked helping people, and so I would ask him, I'd say, hey, you know, have you been working on your truck, or I'd try to drum up some conversation. He goes, man, I really can't do it, my back just doesn't do what it used to do, you know, and I go, oh, yeah, and then, but he would quickly end the conversation because he knew that my spirits were kind of like, oh, man, it's a bummer. But he would end it by saying, praise the Lord, and he would start to testify about how good God was. And so that would raise me up a little bit. I go, okay, yeah, you're right. Yeah, that's right, man. Yeah, you know. So I loved Leonard without knowing him too much. And Terry, my condolences to you and your family. That's it.
Thanks, Chris.
Hi, my name is Jessica. I was Leonard's neighbor across the street. I lived with him across the street since I was 16, so about 13 years I knew Leonard. And he was always there. Wouldn't even pull in the driveway until he waved. He was a very, would come over and his back was bad, but he would stand there with me and teach me how to fix my own car. One day, I thought his house was on fire. His smoke alarm was going off and it had a blinking light on it, and he was waving it outside, but it looked like flames all through the front doorway. And I told my fiance, go, hurry, hurry, the house is on fire. He runs over there, and it was just the smoke detector. Terry burns some bacon. So, and me and my fiance really did try to keep an eye over there just to always keep, just make sure everything was good at copacetic at his house. And he always kept an eye on us, and he always kept an eye on my kids. And I really felt like he did. He loved me and my family, and that's it. He was good.
Thank you for sharing. Yes.
Sorry, many of you know me. I'm Sunny. I've known Leonard my whole life. Cousin, uncle too, one of my best friends. Leonard, because of that man, I have a relationship with many of my family members I wouldn't have otherwise had. Leonard taught me it was okay to forgive and not be afraid of people. Leonard taught me it was okay to disagree with something people did or not like what they do and still love them and still be there for them. And I know all of you are here because he loved you that way too. And I just want to say thank you, God, for one of the best blessings of my life.
Amen. Well done.
Leonard was one of the first people I met when I moved here to Reading back in 2000. And it was actually at Enterprise High School. And then when I heard him talking about cars and stuff like that, I kind of turned around and looked. And then I met him out at the drag strip when he had a 69 Camaro. And I worked for Knapp Auto Parts. And when we first met, we wasn't really good friends. We were just kind of like acquaintances. I would just see him and it'd be like, you know, I just kind of, oh, okay, yeah, okay, you know. But Leonard wouldn't let me go. He wanted me as a friend. Every time he'd come into Napa, he'd wait for me. Everybody would ask at the counter, hey, can I help you? No, I'll wait for Mike. I'm waiting for Mike. No, go ahead. Oh, no, go right ahead. I'll wait for Mike. Yep. Or I'll call back tomorrow. Exactly. And I would get a message from people at counter. Hey, Leonard called for you. Oh, what'd he want? Well, he said he was going to call you back. So I'd call him back. And he would always get parts. He goes, Mike, you know, there's somebody in my church. He says they need their car fixed, need to do a tune-up on their car. And so he'd give me all their information. I'd get him stuff. Okay, well, I'll come in later. And when he'd come in, he would talk to me about Jesus and stuff in his church. And, you know, and I was kind of one of those people for a long time. I kind of tried to shy away from that because I was always pushed into it when I was a child with my family. And so, but Leonard kind of eased me into it. And I know I don't go to church now, but, you know, I have more faith now than what I did when I was younger because of him. And I'm glad I got to become his friend. And he wasn't going to leave me alone until he became my friend. And he did a good job. And, you know, he's most definitely going to be missed by me. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
My name is Sunny, and I'm Leonard's aunt. So I'm like kind of like his big sister. And Nat and I and Leonard and my brother Roy, we grew up together, really, kind of. I was about 14 when Leonard was born. And Linda and I were really close. His mother and I were really close. Who didn't think I was going to do that? But you know, it's funny. You know, there's so much about Leonard. There's so much to say, so much to know. But the particular life we're talking about with Leonard has been there all of his life. He started out, like, on his tricycles, guys. He would find a way to get them apart. It was amazing. Linda would be crazy. Linda and I had this thing we did. We sat in the ER with Leonard. A lot of the times he didn't have a car, and I worked and did. So we went from tricycles, of course, to bikes, to anything that looked like a motocross, and that started early, you know. And then he had mini bikes. Good Lord. Oh my gosh, the way he wrecked those things was absolutely amazing. He was, I mean, you know, even his Uncle Roy said, that's creative, man, I never did that, you know. And, you know, but he was just that way his whole life. He was inclined that way. And, you know, so one of my early vivid memories is I was about 17, and Linda and I lived together quite frequently. We're both kind of single moms, and so we were there, and we supported each other through a lot of stuff. If we didn't live together, we lived next door. It was like, you know, she's in this duplex, I'm in that one. So that's why we grew up together, and I have pictures I found in Ed of you and Lori and Marcy cheerleading out in front of the yard. Leonard was doing the, you know. But one day I came home from school, and we were living in McLeod at the time, and I was like junior or something. I walked up these little back stairs we had, and they were kind of steep coming up. Leonard was probably about 4, and he's standing there. He's got that toothy grin because Leonard couldn't drink. He couldn't or wouldn't drink white milk, so he had to have chocolate milk in his bottle, and it kind of caused him to lose his front teeth early. And so he always had this little toothless grin. It was so funny. But he had this look, and it's kind of like the one in that picture there. And you had to really be on your guard when he had that look. And I came home, and I had my books like this, holding them up by my chest, and I'm looking, and I'm walking up, and as I'm walking up, he's about this tall, right? I got just about the right level, and I said, where are you up to? And he goes, wham! and he hit me in the solar plexus. He literally stopped my heart for a minute. I fell back and I was blue. And he was going, you know, because we sparred a lot, right? And he was like, and Linda comes out, my sister comes out and goes, what are you laughing at? Because she knew Leonard's laughs. And she looks down, she goes, oh my God. You know, and I'm trying to get air right. So that was one of the many times that Leonard really got me in the heart, many, many times. Lots of ways, you know, and just so many things, so many daily things, you know, and I thank God for all those things. I thank God for family, no matter what it looks like to us now. We're still family. We're all family. My God, that's the one thing Leonard loved the most. He loved that the most, guys. Value it. Value it no matter what it looks like. See, life changes. Things go on. And you know what? Love is still love. Hate will go away. Hate will go away. It will. If you just hang on to what? Just even the smallest drop of love. That's what meant a lot to Leonard. He wasn't just in this family of God for the purpose of being here as some kind of a nominal Christian that comes in here. This is where he learned about family. And this is what he loved. He loved family, and this was the attraction for him. And he wanted people to be part of not just his family, no matter what, to graft them in. He wanted them to be a part of this family, to be whole and to be free. You know, he had his issues. We all have issues. We could sit here and write them out for days, right? Every one of us. But the bottom line is, he recovered from them. He moved on. He really did. And that's part of his legacy, is love. He got it from his mom. His grandmother was the one that taught him how to witness. That woman would witness to a fence post if she thought he could get it saved, you know. And he learned that from her. He rode around, traveled with her a lot. He became my mother's traveling buddy. She'd go see her sisters, you know, in Southern California, Arizona, and Leonard would be her travel buddy. But his mother was the one who loved. She loved everybody. I don't care who they were, how they were. She had no judgments. I never saw anyone like her. She was the most amazing woman there was. And the one thing she taught us all is to love. And love should trump judgment, because the Bible does tell us that, you know, it does. It trumps judgment. So I just, you know, there's too many for me to even try to go to. I just know one of the things that happened, we get up to ER, and every time, they never put Leonard's file back down in medical records. They just left it in ER. And Linda walked in, and all the nurses knew us. Hey, how you guys doing? What did he do this time? She'd grab his file. It was right there in the ER. And then we'd sit, and we'd talk, and then we'd usually get some ice cream or something. I don't know how he worked that out, but he did. But you know what? If you want to leave any legacy for Leonard, you'll leave love. That was his legacy.
Well said. Thank you.
Hi. I'm Melissa, and for about 9 years, I was so blessed to be one of his children. And I'm not sure how this is going to come out, so I apologize ahead of time. But in October, me and Dad were hunting, and we went a few times. And one of the times, we were talking about something super, super deep. It was actually about how well Charlie knew the area we were hunting in, and he was bragging about him and how much he loved Charlie, and how if we, you know, got lost, we didn't have to worry. We would just call up Charlie, and Charlie would tell us, you know, what do you see? Mountains, pine trees. Okay, at the fifth pine tree, turn right. You know, and Charlie would get us out of our situation. And at that moment, he just pauses, and he goes, quick, give me the gun, give me the gun. And I was like, what? Okay, here you go. And he stopped the car and he pulled over, and we see this gorgeous, like 350-pound, 400-pound bear. And it had like golden fur, and it was just beautiful. And unfortunately, long story short, it heard the door shutting, turned around and started running away. So you know, wouldn't shoot at it, of course, so we kind of missed that opportunity. But I learned something that impacted me for life that day, which I never understood in the Bible, where it says, give thanks in all circumstances. I'm like, why, God? I mean, if in something, if in a circumstance that's so horrible, where your heart hurts so much, or you're in such dire straits, or you just don't understand why, how could you command us to give thanks in all circumstances? And, you know, in that moment, I understood, because for the rest of the day, like, we were only about, you know, maybe we started at 6 a.m. I think we saw the bear at about noon, so we were only halfway through. And for the rest of the day until about 5:30, 6, when we started heading back, he would, you know, spontaneously be like, "Man, thank you, Lord. That bear was so beautiful. Wasn't it beautiful with the golden fur and the honey eyes and it was so beautiful. Thank you, Lord, for letting us see that bear." Even though we didn't get the bear, we didn't even get to shoot at the bear. It was just the fact that he got to see the bear. He was so thankful. And that impacted me so much, because even though you have bad circumstances, like, this is a bad circumstance. But for 9 years, I got to call the most incredible man that I've ever met in my life, Dad. Like, I got to realize the last 4 years or so that I couldn't have received a greater blessing. And so now I understand the saying, like, praise you in the storm. This is a storm, but I'm able to praise God through it because of the blessing behind it. So I thank my dad for that.
Well said.
Hello, my name is Mercedes.
Leonard is my papa. As far back as I can remember, papa and I have had a great relationship. My mom and dad told me, I don't think I can do it. My mom and dad told me the moment I was born, papa called me his angel. Papa would take me and my cousins to church almost every Sunday. He loved the Lord so much. I remember going on drives and he would have Christian music up so loud, we would just sing to it. Papa had a great heart. He loved everyone, even without knowing them. Every time we would see a homeless person, he would pray for them. We always had fun when he was with our family. We would ride mini bikes and go-karts. He was so proud of me for riding my mini bike.
We would go camping, hiking, and run the RC cars. Papa loved to eat Red Robin. It was his favorite. I love my papa so much, and we'll miss him so much. But I know he is in heaven and no more pain. He is now my forever angel.
Hello, my name is Haley. I am Mercedes' best friend. I thought of Leonard as my grandpa. He was so sweet and kind. Every time I would see him, he would give me a big hug and make me feel like I was one of his grandchildren. This last summer, my family went camping a couple times with Leonard and Mercedes' family. We had so much fun and around the campfire, riding our bikes around the campsite and splashing in cold creek water. Leonard would take me to church with them on Sunday mornings. My family will miss Leonard, and we all love him. Thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Here's another song that Leonard wanted to share with you guys on this day. doubt we live in a beautiful area. And one of the special treats now that we have is for many, many years, if you were a veteran and you wanted to be buried in a military cemetery, your choice was down by, what do you call it? No, I'm sorry. I shouldn't ask you a question because you're trying to answer it. Down by Vallejo down there, or you'd have to go up by Medford, way north. And so there was nothing in the North State, really. And then the Lord did bless us with our local veterans cemetery. And the reason I bring that is because of our location. Either myself or one of our other pastors are up there almost every month doing a service. And it's quite an honor, I have to tell you. And many years ago, I was there. And when I first started doing these services, it was a lot of the honor guard were a lot of the World War II gentlemen. And they're no longer doing that. And now we're into the Vietnam veterans that are there. And so I showed up, and it was a military service. And the guys were there, and they had their motorcycles there. They were standing outside the chapel. They were lined up. They were greeting people as they came in. They weren't really in uniform. They were, but you knew exactly from their patches where they served. And so they just greeted everybody with a loving, genuine, like, thank you for coming. So people walked in. And I was sitting there, and then it was time for the military to do their presentation of the flag to the family. And so off to the side, there was three military people, two young men and a young woman. They were probably in their early 20s at best. And so they walked in, and they began to share and presented the flag, and they said what they said, then they sat down. But while I was sitting here, one word kept coming to my mind. I haven't forgotten it. Family. 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 And the reason I mention that is because within this room that day, there was the military family, the guys and gals outside. There was the younger military family in uniform. And there was a connection between them that you can't put into words. They're from different states. They didn't even know each other. But there was something that they had in common, that they were family. And then I got up to speak, and just like today, there's the biological family. And there's a connection there that you just can't put into words. It just is. And then there's the family of common things. Maybe you are connected through racing or through motorcycles or through all kinds of things. Family is a word that's used pretty loosely sometimes. But when you know it, you can't take it away. Amen? And I'm here to tell you, the greatest joy I have is that I'm a part of his family for eternity. And the thing that bonds us together is not because Leonard and I are such good-looking men. It's not it. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that brings us together. And that this time here, as powerful as it has been, is nothing in comparison to eternity. And at the beginning, I used a word on purpose. I said, this is going to be a joyful day, not a happy day. If you're happy today, this is just, you're just weird, okay? But joy is to choose in the midst of sorrow, in the midst of tears, because of what's ahead. And the reason I can use that word, the reason I can say that I'm a part of Leonard's family, is because there was a day in Leonard's life when he did exactly what the love letter, I call it the Bible, the love letter of God, says for you and for me. This is what it says. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. I love the way the Bible describes what's happening with Leonard. He's not asleep. He's at rest. I don't ever remember a day when Leonard was not in physical pain. I don't ever remember a day where he mentioned it. He just lived through it. But now, he can turn his neck freely. He can bend. He can get on his knees to worship God Almighty. Wow. Yeah. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep, those that have passed on. The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. What do you mean? He and those that are with him one day, Jesus is going to return. And those that have died before us, they'll get up when Jesus gets up to return with us. And when we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. I love those words because they're true. So what do we do after today? He wasn't done. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. We receive the comfort. And to know Jesus is simply to say yes to his invitation. There's nothing that you have to do. You don't have to get baptized. You don't have to work at the mission. You don't have to give free food. You don't have to do any of that. How do you know that? Because when Jesus was on the cross that day before he took his last breath, there was a guy next to him, and all he said was, "Remember me." That guy couldn't do anything except die a horrible, painful life. But Jesus said, "Today, you'll be with me." Wow. That's why we have hope today. That's why we can celebrate today. And again, as Leonard would say, John 3:17. John 3:17 for you. John 3:17 for me. We celebrate that. Father, we thank you for loving us first. We thank you for allowing your Holy Spirit to choose to live within our heart. In those times when I'm sure Leonard didn't want to say, "This is all good," the Holy Spirit prompted him to say, "It's going to be okay." And so we thank you, God, for that spirit. We thank you also for sharing his life with us. We thank you for the investment that he made in us. And now we can take that investment in this family, and us as family members can share it also. To your glory, Lord Almighty, we love you. Amen. One last video I want to share with you guys.
Hey there now, where'd you go? You left me here, so unexpected. You changed my life, I hope you know. 'Cause now I'm lost, so unprotected. In the blink of an eye, I never got to say goodbye. Like a shooting star, flying across the room, so fast, so far. You were gone too soon. You're part of me, and I'll never be the same here without you. You were gone too soon. You were always there, like a shining light. On my darkest days, you were there to guide me. Oh, I miss you now. I wish you could see just how much your memory will always mean to me.
that's a love letter from God, and it's our guide to how we should live and how we should be. And I'll tell you right now, read Revelations, we win in the end. There's nothing to be afraid of. God bless. Love you, brothers and sisters. Get your Bibles.
One day there'll be no more waiting left for our souls. One day there'll be no more children longing for home. One day when the kingdom comes right here where we stand, we will see the promised land. One day there'll be no more lives taken too soon. One day there'll be no more need for a hospital. One day every tear that falls will be wiped by His hair. We will see the promised land. Sin won't cause a divide. One day we'll be family standing hand in hand, and we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land. Hallelujah. There will be healing from this heartache we've been feeling. One day when our tired and weary bones find their rest. One day when the power of evil's brought to an end, we will see the promised land. We will see the promised land.
Can we stand together? On June 5th, that Wednesday evening, Terry was here, and we had the great opportunity to pray with Terry, for Terry, because the next day, as you know, family members, the decision needed to be made. What are we going to do? And previous to that, when Terry told me, yeah, Leonard's got COVID, in my mind I thought, COVID, big deal. That's Leonard. Honestly, that's what I thought. That's Leonard. And the reason I say that, COVID did not take Leonard. On January 6th, Jesus says, I want to see my boy. And And so on that day, you did what we prayed for. We said, God, he is totally your care. You're a miracle maker. You can heal him. We've seen you do it before. He's walking. And so, God, we're going to place him totally in your care without any man-made stuff. And the Lord graciously said, I'll take it from here. And I want to say to you, Annette, and to you, Terry, and to the family, the Lord is with you. He loves you. We want to be there to just remind you how loved you are and know that. As you look around today, there's so many people here, so many people watching that will be watching, and we just want to say again, we love you. And may God continue to richly bless your life. Amen. God bless you guys. Thank you for being here.